260. Call in on any math topic. We are here to answer your phone calls. So do call in from 6 to 7. Any math topic that you're ready to tackle and do with our teachers, they're ready to hear from you. And remember that every time that you call in, you also get put in a raffle for a t-shirt from Math Homework Hotline. Those t-shirts, remember, look like one of these beautiful golden shirts. Boom. And then do take us on the go. We are live streaming on www.mathhomeworkhotline.com. You can actually find us a couple of different ways, but that's usually the quickest way, www.mathhomeworkhotline.com. So take us on the go. You notice on a different website that's on the screen, that's another way you could get to us. So a couple of different ways you could link into our live stream. All right, with that being said, Kenilla, you gave us the fun theme for today, which was Disney with a little Hispanic heritage
twist. Absolutely.
What is the math topic that's going to be on air tonight?
I'm really excited about this one. I find that this topic is important, and literally I have seen kids that are in AP physics using this on the regular. So this is one of those skills you will use forever, like all the way through college. So let's see it. Tonight's topic is proportional relationships. And we actually worked some proportions in a previous episode this year, but tonight we're gonna focus entirely on them. It's gonna be awesome.
Exactly. So you guys, as we are working through proportional relationships, what's gonna happen next is you're gonna see one of our challenge questions comes up. So a challenge question, what it'll do is it'll come up on your screen, we'll talk through it quickly, and then you got to take a picture or somehow pause your screen, pause the live feed. So like that, you can see, work it out, be the first caller to be able to answer it correctly and explain it to one of our math teachers. And then you can win our Jimmy Award because our math question, our challenge question is brought to you by our sponsors, which are Mathnasium and EdGems. Canella's going to read to you the challenge question, and then we'll show you all the prizes that you get by being the first caller in. Okay, so you getting ready? Get ready to see that challenge question.
All right, let's see it. I'm excited. The challenge questions are always so much fun. Let's go to the board and let's show it. All right, tonight's challenge question. Get those phones out. Get ready. Get ready to screenshot or take that photo.
Get it out there, sir.
Okay, our challenge problem is, in the story Snow White and the Seven Dwarves, the phrase fairest of them all is used often. Also at my house.
Yes.
But if fairest of them all appears four times in the first 16 pages, and it is proportional to the number of times it appears in the 80-page book, so then how many times does fairest of them all appear in total? So let me rephrase that. So if it appears four times in the first 16 pages, and that is a proportional relationship, how many will it appear in 80 pages? All right, so call in and be ready to not only give the right answer, but explain how you got it, and then you get to do it live on air and show off all of your math genius.
So by being the very first caller to do that, remember the phone number 813-840-7260, you'll be able to win our Jimmy Award, which
Ooh.
Comes with a plaque that looks just like this, and it'll be personalized with your name. This is, look, hardwood, nice plaque. It'll have your name and your school at the bottom personalized. But this is our Jimmy Award that goes out, again, for the very first person each week that earns that privilege of being the caller with the answer. Beyond this, though, from EdGems, we have Mathnasium prizes, as well as our Math Homework Hotline t-shirt. So, Kenilla, what are those prizes?
All right, so we have the very wonderful, we gotta have, stay hydrated, the water bottle. We can never have enough of those, I swear. The kids use them all the time. This lovely bag that is great for carrying anything. You could carry your books in here. I always think of gym clothes for some reason. It seems the perfect size for that. But any you could tote, like Maggie said, you could use it at the beach. You can use it anywhere. Perfect. We can all use another reusable bag. Good for the environment. Then we have Canoodle. This is a 2D and 3D puzzle game. It's compact size. It's super fun. It's like helps with your brain to work on the math side of your brain. And it's great. Compact size, fits in your backpack or your pocket, as do the Mathnasium cards. And when we get to Integer Week, I'm going to show you how to play Integer Wars with that. Let's not forget the squeezy, which I did use last week when we did a little bit of probability.
Yes.
But it's also great just for getting your stress out. And then all kinds of pens and pencils that
all from
Edgems and Post-it notes. And then the grand prize for Mathnasium is a free diagnostic assessment. That way you can go in and see where your strengths are, and they'll develop a custom plan for you to make you sure that you reach your full math potential. With 7 locations throughout the city, there's got to be one with just a few minutes of your house. So thank you, Mathnasium and Edgems. And don't forget that t-shirt that Maggie is showing off right now.
There it is.
Okay, the beautiful t-shirt.
So I'll tell you, with every week by you calling in and being that Demi winner, we get to show off and do a big shout out to last week's winner, which Ooh. You'll see a picture of him and his math teacher shortly. But this is going to be Keeland over at, make sure I get this right, Williams Middle.
All right, Keeland.
With his math teacher, Mrs. Ferguson. So it is Williams Middle Magnet IB. He was super happy. Notice that he's holding our plaque. He's currently in the mail to him right now is the one that has his actual name on it.
Awesome.
But we wanted to make sure that you saw what it looked like, all those great happy faces out there. And I will tell you, he was our very third Jimmy Award winner, which is exciting. But even more exciting, last week we determined the very first Teacher Jimmy Award. So I would tell you, if you go back to us and here live in the studio, in living color, we have our very first Teacher Jimmy Award winner, which is none other than Canela. So Miss Prado is our very first Jimmy Teacher Award winner. And her first period was the one with the highest number of participation calls into the show for the first 3 shows of the season. So first period, kids are going to get to see me come shortly as soon as I get their plaque. And be able to show that off, and then they get a PDQ card for a free entree.
Yum.
So exciting stuff happening here. So remember, call in. You're not just watching, you're also calling in to be able to get points for your class, be one of our winners from the raffle to get a shirt, and also be able to get some of those class prizes and so forth. Already, you guys, we have a challenge winner, and this is what we're about here on the show.
I can't believe it.
Let's go.
And no time flat, we have, I believe, Jamie is on the line with us. Jamie?
Yes.
Hi, Jamie. Can you tell us who your teacher is?
Mrs. Hunt,
and that's from Williams, correct?
Yes.
All right. They've told me that you have the right answer, so I'm going to read the problem to you, and then you're going to explain to me how you got the right answer, okay?
Okay.
All right. So if we go to the board, in the story Snow White and the Seven Dwarves, the phrase "fairest of them all" is used often. If the phrase appears 4 times in 16 pages, how many times will it appear in 80 pages? So the theme of tonight is proportions. I'm hoping you used a proportion, but it's fine if you used another way. So let's go ahead and tell me how you solved it.
So if you use 4 times in 16 pages.
Yep.
So if you multiply 16 by 10, then you get 80 pages.
Okay. So if you multiplied 16 times 5, you would get 80 pages. Okay. Okay. 16.
And then 4 multiplied by 5 is 20. Because you have to multiply.
Yes. Yes.
I mean the 5.
Okay, and you got 20, and that is exactly right. What you use there is called equivalent ratios, and that was perfect, perfect, perfect. I was very proud of you. Great job.
Can you put an equal sign between those two fractions to make my Maggie heart happy?
Yes.
Yes. Or Disney happy, happy.
There you go. All right, thank you,
that
Jamie.
That was awesome,
proud
Jamie.
Of you. That was perfect. Good job.
Jamie makes it look so easy, you guys. See? Our very first Jimmy, our first call of the night, and our Jimmy Award winner. So our Jimmy Award tonight goes to Jamie over at Williams. Lots of great still time, guys, to call in with your questions. So don't forget to call us. Canella's going to have our very first question tonight with this proportional relationships. We are bringing the questions to you from our Edgems reviews. So like that, you can follow along as you're doing this unit as well. Okay? All right, Canella.
All right. So my first question of the night is just going to be the basics of a proportion and solving it. Okay. So if we can go to the board, we have, what is the value of X in the proportion 9 over 12 equals 12 over X? So what I teach the kids to do is simply to cross multiply. So we have 9X. And then we go ahead and cross multiply again. 9 times X is 9X. 12 times 12 is 144. Now we have a one-step equation. So what we do is we do the opposite to get isolate X. We need to do the opposite of multiply because 9 is a coefficient. So what this really means is 9 times X. So if we divide both sides by 9, what we get is 9 divided by 9 would equal 1X. So we've isolated the X. See that? He's become just 1X. And then 144 divided by 9 is 16. And it's that simple. You cross multiply and divide by the coefficient. All right, so we have another caller.
All right.
Hi, is this Camille?
Yes.
Hey, Camille.
Hi, Camille.
I think he's ready to do a question with me.
All right, let's do this.
All right, so we've been talking about proportional relationships, and we're gonna put you to the test a little bit. We're gonna go from 0 to 60 quick, all right? So if we are understanding fractions a little bit, remember the word ratio sounds like a whole lot like a fraction, right? And I say to you 6/15, and I say which of these ratios form a proportion with 6/15, what am I really asking you?
I'm sorry.
Yes. So basically, yeah, no problem. So what I have is this target of 6/15, okay? That's like my magic fraction right now. And this magical fraction with Disney magic, of course, we're being asked which ratio of the ones that are given to us, and there's six different setups here, six different choices, form a proportion with this 6/15. So my question to you was, what are they asking us to do?
Well, I'm pretty sure to solve if we have to simplify this.
Exactly. So you said the word simplify, which I love the word simplify. So we're looking basically for equivalent ratios, right? Or fractions that are going to equal 6/15. So let's think about it. Is 3/5, does that equal or is that equivalent to 6/15?
Yes.
Why would you say yes?
Actually, no.
No? I agree with your no, but why did you change your answer?
Well, that's because of 3 equivalent to 6.
Exactly. So even if I said 3 times 2 is 6, is 5 times 2 15?
No, it's
not, right? So that's why we say, okay, if we multiply, we have to multiply the top and the bottom by the same number. If we were to have done that because 3 times 2 is 6, that's no way going to give us the same number at the bottom, right? So I agree with you that it's a no. So my next question is it equivalent to 10 over 25? And there's different ways that we could do this. One way that I heard you say was simplify. I'm going to challenge you. There's another way that I learned actually later in my years, okay, that when I do a cross multiplication, it's like a cross, like when we're doing the diagonals, like the butterflies. If the butterfly wings are the same, they actually are going to be an equivalent ratio or give you a proportion. So let's try it that way for this one, okay? What's 10 times 15?
150.
That's a beautiful thing. So I'm going to write that down over here on that side of that little butterfly, okay? What is 25 times 6? 150 as well. You got it. So now, since the numbers are the same, can we say that these two fractions are proportional? Their ratios, do they form a proportion? Yes, they do. So basically, we would go through that same process, you know, throughout the whole time, whichever method works for you. So we just keep comparing these, and we say, do these look like they would be proportional or be equal to each other. Now this one I would actually go backwards. 6 times what is 18? So you said 3? And then if I were to multiply by 3 at the bottom, is 15 times 3 45? It sure is, right? So I'm so excited that you got that right. Exactly. So that's the process that we use. We just started thinking about simplifying. We started thinking about just doing your cross products, maybe even working a little bit backwards, you know, because here I could have divided by 3, or 45 divided by 3, we know is 15. Now, just to make life a little bit easier as we go through the rest of these, I'm going to tell you that there's only one more that is going to be equal. And I'm going to throw off out F already because I'm looking at this and I'm thinking there's no way I'm going to get 6 times some decimal that's going to give me 11, and that's going to be the same decimal that I multiply 15 by to get 20, all right? This one looks a little tricky, so I know I'm on the bottom line, I'm kind of going backwards, but you remember that 2 over 8, it looks like divided by 5 eighths, really should be multiplying by the reciprocal. So if I multiply by the reciprocal, notice how my 8s go away, and I just have 2 fifths, okay? So 2 fifths, does that look like 6 over 15? So think of a number that I multiply 2 by to get 6. Is that same number times 5 going to give me 15? Exactly. So we multiply by 3, right? So we know that that one indeed worked out as well. You're so good at these. And then this last one, when we check it, these are taking a little bit longer. And I know that, sometimes it's like we just got to take our time to kind of go through each of the problems, make sure that we got it squared out. And again, this one doesn't look like it's going to give us what we need because we don't have a factor, if you will, or something that we can multiply by to get from the 6 to the 15. That's going to be that same number we multiply 15 by to get 25. Thank you so much for working with us for this one. We ended up with 3 ratios of form
and
proportion.
Right.
We're 6
fifteenths. Always need extra practice with select all.
Yes.
I feel like we can never have enough practice with select all. Looks like we have Mateo live on air with us. Hello, Mateo. How are you?
I'm doing good.
Good. Yay. We're gonna solve a proportion. Are you ready? Let's do this.
Let's do
it. Okay.
All right. So Mo walked 12 miles in 3 hours. How far will he walk in 5 hours? So what I like to do is always with a proportion, it's a fraction equals a fraction. The hardest part is making sure you set it up right. So what are the 2 categories of that we would label here? What words are the labels here? We got Mo walked 12 miles in 3 hours. What are our labels if I was going to label this fraction? Do you know one? How about miles? You see that?
Yeah, miles in hours.
Yeah, you got it. He knew this.
Yes, he did.
All right, so where's 12 going to go? Is it going to go in the numerator or the denominator? Is it going in the numerator or the denominator? Above or below? Is it says 12?
It's okay. 12 the miles or?
Yeah, 12 miles. So it's going to go where?
Okay. Oh, the numerator?
Yes. And then what goes in the denominator with that?
The hours.
Which is how many? He walked 12 miles in how many hours?
3 hours.
Okay. And then what's the other number we have left? We use this one. What do we have left?
5 hours.
Is it going in the numerator or the denominator?
Denominator.
So then that leaves us with we don't know, right? We don't know how far. Does that make sense? How far is miles afar? Yes, miles is a increment for far. So we're going to put an X there. All right, now what's the next step to solve this? Do you know, Mateo?
You're going to have to do 12 times 5.
Yep, we're going to cross multiply. And 12 times 5 equals what?
It would equal 60.
Okay, and then what's the next step? You're doing awesome.
The next step is you would divide by 3.
Right, first we got to multiply 3 times x and get 3x, and you are right. Past that, we would divide by 3 to isolate the x variable, because 3 divided by 3 is 1. And then what's 60 divided by 3? Can you do that in your head?
Ooh.
That would be 20.
He's got it.
Yes.
Ding, 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 ding. And what are we labeling this? 20 what?
20 miles.
Yay! That is perfection. Mateo, I could not be more proud of you. Thank you for calling in. We really appreciate these phone calls and love talking and working with all of you guys.
Yes. And guys, sometimes it takes a little bit to get through the phone lines if you want to call in, because remember, we have all these great questions coming through. Don't despair. Still call in. Not a problem, all right? As you see, I'm going to work our Disney magic with these problems. Here's our little Mickey Mouse ears, compliments from Miss Prado again, you know, with our magical themes. So the question is, triangles are similar and have scale factors, or a scale factor of 6 to 5. Let's do a little bit of vocabulary here. When you're talking about triangles being similar, they're saying basically they're corresponding. So if I have a triangle and I have a specific side of that triangle that corresponds with the other, like here, the y and the x are corresponding. If I know that there's a scale factor of 6 to 5, that means that we use some type of proportion, right? To make it so like that, I don't know about you, but this colon also can be seen as a fraction. And very similar to what we were doing in the prior problem, we're looking for which of these choices, and again, it's multi-select. Typically you have more than four choices, but we're just gonna play with these first four and see how we do with those. Are they in proportion with this 6 to 5 ratio, okay? So you think about it, I'm doing the same thing I was doing before. I'm trying to see, are these proportional or not? I like the strategy of multiplying the diagonals and I can see right quick. So for instance, here, 5 times 12, I know it's 60. And 60 and 66 are not equal to each other, so I know that this first one is not gonna work. All right, so again, I'm going back to which ones of these triangles, these possible lengths would give me a scale factor that, if you will, of 6 to 5. So I'm going back to the 6/5, I make it look like a fraction, put it equal to 42/35, and I'm just testing it out. Really, there should be a question mark right there. And as I test it out, I am gonna use my handy tool of a calculator because we can, all right? So I literally am using the TI-30XA, any kind of four function calculator to do this for us. 6 times 35 equals 210. And then I do 42 times 5, and yes, I could have done this very quickly in my head if I needed to or show my work, but showing you that for sure our tools are an essential part of what we do as well. Because the diagonals were equal to each other, that means that those are also equivalent fractions or ratios. So that would definitely be another one of those dimensions that would work. Now, I'm going to tell you, there's one more. And sometimes we don't like to deal with these fractions, guys, but don't make it look so crazy and spooky, right? It's Disney magic. So 6/5, is that equal to 3/2.5? All right, so think about it. If I divide 6 by 2, don't I get 3? I sure do. Well, if I were to divide the bottom by 2, the denominator, 5 divided by 2, isn't that 2.5? It sure is. So I could do this a number of different ways. If I would have done my diagonals, it would have given me the same number, which was 15 for both. And then since I told you there was only one other one, that one was it. 10/12 is not gonna work. I just wanna prove that to you because it kind of looks like it should work, but only if it would have been inverted, all right? But the way it stands, 6 to 5 is not equal to 10 to 12. So no way, Jose. So those are the triangles, how we can deal with proportions, more of a geometry type of setting, and make it easy peasy, lemon squeezy. All right, back to you, Canela.
Great. All right, so I am gonna talk about more about what a proportion would look like in a table. So it's very important that you know what it looks like and learn a couple of rules about it. So let's go to the board. What is the constant of proportionality of the table below? And so what this is representing is on a coordinate plane, what the XY coordinates would be. So what are the couple of rules that you have to do here? So our constant of proportionality, one, it has to go through the origin, okay? It has to go through 0, 0. That's the first thing. And then the second thing, for it to have a constant of proportionality, y divided by x has to equal the same thing every single time. So let's start with this nice, beautiful table I have drawn here. Let's start with number one, has to go through 0, 0. So what that means is the xy at some point has to be 0, 0. Well, here we have x and y are both 0. So check, ding, 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 that worked. All right, now, every time on here. Does y over x equal the same thing? So this is where kids often get tripped up. Because we do often tables in alphabetical order, x, y, they get confused and they would think that this is, perhaps this one here would be 1/3. Nay. Okay, so it would be y over x. So we're going with y over x. So our y here would be 3. And our x would be 1. Okay, the next one, it would be 6 over 2. Not 2 over 6, that would be x over y. This is y over x every single time. Then 9 over 3, and on the last one, it would be 12 over 4. So, having said that, now I need to say, okay, well, these look the same, but do they simplify to be the exact same thing? You got to remember, it's got to be exactly, and it can't, if even one of them, even one does not equal 3, it's done. Okay, so let's check. This one, 3 divided by 1 is 3. 6 divided by 2 is 3, 9 divided by 3 is 3, and 12 divided by 4 is 3. This is, in fact, a constant of proportionality, and we know this because we checked, but it did tell us. And so, therefore, the constant of proportionality for this is simply 3, or you could say 3 over 1. They're equivalent, yes?
Yes.
All right. Hey, I think we have a caller.
We do.
I think it's Angel Leal.
Yeah.
Hi, Angel Leal. Are you ready to do some math with us?
Yeah.
Giving it a try. All right.
All right. I want you in your own words. Here's the very first question. You're going to get a little tiny baby questions from these before you see the board. What's a proportion? Do you know what a proportion is?
Kind of.
Okay. So if you had to explain it to someone, let's say you were talking to a fifth grader, okay? And you're like, hey, I learned something new in math today. A proportion. And they say, well, what is that? What would you tell them? Like, in your own words, how would you describe it to someone else?
I would kind of describe it as, sort of thing with, five candies and, how much that is. Putting that inside a fraction form.
Exactly. All right. So I love that. So with that in mind, you know that we can build, Ms. Prada just showed a table, right? And the person before ours. Now I'm going to ask you, in the form of an equation, we're going to pick out which ones of these can look like a proportional relationship, okay? So looking at the board, I've written the equations down in three different lines. Now I'm going to make life a little easier on you. I'm going to tell you that in every line, so in this first line, if we were to ignore everything below it, only one of these is going to give us a proportional relationship equation. And the next line, only one of these two is going to be the proportional one, and then the same thing's going to happen down here. Now, you're not always going to get those hints in a math class, right? But for tonight, we're doing Disney magic, and we can make it happen for you. All right, so if I'm thinking, one of the things Ms. Prado already said is, in order for a proportional relationship to exist, like in a graph or in a table, we have to use the point 0, 0, right? The origin?
Yeah.
So literally, it has to pass through the origin. So do you see, in one of these two relationships, which one do you think, just if you had to give it, your gut feeling, if I were to start creating a table or I started creating a graph of these first two, which one do you believe would be a proportional relationship where it would be literally a straight line?
I think B.
You said B?
B.
Exactly. B would be exactly that. And if you notice, I could have written that as 1/4 x. All right. That's exactly right. Because if I were to put in an x of 0, 0 times 1/4 is going to give me 0. So the point 0, 0 would have definitely been a point on that graph. So that first line, you did beautifully. Ready for the second line? All right. Here we go. We're going to do this. So y equals 7x. Y equals 8 to the power of x. If you had to take a gut feeling, if you were thinking about the points that go along with these two equations, where do you think 0, 0 would show up? If I put in a 0 here for my input, would I get an output of 0? If I put in an input of 0 here, would I get an output of 0? Which one do you think would be the more likely, just by doing that one test? All right, I'm going to tell you, if I put in x to the power, x as an input, the power of 0, 8 to the power of 0 is actually going to give me 1. So that one is not going to be it. Good try, though. How about here, if I put in an x of 0, what's 0 times 7? That is indeed 0, so thank you. You got that one, okay? We got that. Not a big deal. All right, so let's do the very, very last row here, the E and the F choices, all right?
Okay.
All right, so if I were to say to you, one of these two equations is going to model a proportional relationship, what I'm really looking at is a quick way of checking is I'm looking to, if I put an input of 0, my x value is 0, where would I get a y value of 0? So if I were to put in a 0 right here in the spot of the denominator, do you see how that is not going to be a great thing?
Yeah.
Because anything divided by 0, it's going to be undefined, if you will, or might sometimes will give you an error. So we know that's not going to work. But over here, look what happens. Negative 2/3 times 0, we get the magical 0 for our output. So we know that that one for sure is going to work. So congratulations, and remind me the name?
Angel Leal.
Angel Leal. And now we have some t-shirts.
Yay,
going straight to that.
T-shirt winners.
So t-shirt winners are coming from 3 different schools. Notice that from Williams, we have Anthony calling in and getting a shirt. From Walker, we have Sindhu. All right, mm-hmm. And from Benito, we have Emmanuel. So congratulations, yes. You guys. That is an awesome shirt. So our segment on Ed Gems is coming up next. Are you ready to see that? This is our Ed Gems Gem Award, if you will, Gemmy Awards. But we also come with gems from Ed Gems. These are available to you in your consumable books. If you notice, this one is showcasing our unit review. So at the top, it shows you 4 key elements, if you will, of what would be great about a unit review. It checks your understanding, it's targeted practice for your assessment, it is definitely located in your workbook, and it is available digitally. This is what it looks like if you were online, that icon, and then if you were being able to see it in Spanish or you wanted to have that potential, it's available in Spanish as well. But it is those quick reviews, guys. It is provided for every single unit. You go over key skills, concepts of the unit. It closely mirrors what the assessments are going to look like. The teachers can definitely edit. Students can look at, track their own, checks for understanding. But the most important thing, whether you like to see it in print version or in digital version, it is available for you either way. And the fact that if you wanted to test out, you know, some of our Spanish, we could do that, our Spanish skills as well. So another one of our gems from Ed Gems.
That's right.
Very exciting to be our sponsor. And it is available for us, like I said, especially now with the Hispanic Heritage theme for tonight, to be in that Spanish language and helping out some of our families to kind of do the math with
exactly.
Our students.
Yes, I love it. I love that it's also available in Spanish because a lot of times our students are bilingual and sometimes their parents are less bilingual, and that gives them an option to look and see exactly what their kids are doing. And that's
exactly.
Awesome. Awesome. It's always nice to be able to speak in your first language from time to time and read in your first language from time to time. So I have a great problem. So I'm going to talk a little bit more about sort of the parent equation for a constant of proportionality. So this question is about a table, but there's no table.
Oh.
So a table has a constant of proportionality of 5. So which equation models the proportional relationship? So what it's asking, what you have to know here is you have to know what the parent equation looks like, or else you won't be able to do this. So basically, you're going to need it to look like y equals x, and then whatever the constant is would go in front. Okay, so in this case, our constant is 5. So our coefficient would there be 5. So that shows the constant change, the 5. So every time you get 5 times x, you will get y. That is what we're going for. So when it asks for that, what's the constant of proportionality? What you're looking for is the coefficient of y that number, in this case 5, and does it follow this? All right, so this is what we're looking for. So a lot of kids will just real quick look at it and be like, done. All right, so this is why this is not. This is really a 1 in front of here, okay? 1x. So when there's nothing as a coefficient, there's really
an invisible one.
An invisible one. Little bit of Disney magic there.
Yes.
And always. So that's not it. Now this one has a number and a coefficient in front of one. I mean, in front of x, but it's 1/5. And so 1/5 is not 5. It's, in fact, it's the reciprocal. So no. And then this one sometimes will get kids because, aha, it has a whole 5. These didn't have a whole 5, but this one does. But this is actually the y-intercept. And the y-intercept will always be 0. Always be 0 on a proportional relationship because of what I told you last time. Proportional relationships always go through the origin of 0, 0. So it's not 5. This one would be not a proportional relationship. Okay, so that gives us the last one, which is, in fact, what we wrote down. So that is it. Ding, 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 ding.
Ding, ding, ding,
ding. So it's a little bit about understanding what the equation of a proportional relationship would look like.
Exactly.
There we go. I think we have a caller.
We do. Who are we talking to?
Vidoon.
Is this?
Yeah, hi, Vidoon. Hi.
If you've been tuning in, notice that we've been doing proportional relationships, and we've seen it now in the form of a table, an equation. And now we're going to be looking at a graph. So are you ready for this?
Yes,
I think you are ready for sure. So I'm going to give you 6 choices. And I'm going to tell you that of those 6 choices, only 2 are correct. When I ask which graphs show a proportional relationship. Now, if you're not so sure about proportional relationships, I could give you a hint. It's very similar to a table. It has to go through 0, 0. It has to be a straight line. So these are criteria or key features I'm looking for. Because remember, with a proportional relationship, as the x values increases, the y value increases as well, right? So it is what it is. Actually, that's not going to be true for one of the ones that I'm about to show you. But as the x increases, the y actually decreases. But let's just kind of use these two as our measures, okay? It has to go through 0, 0, and it has to be a straight line. Of the 6 that I've shown you, which ones can we eliminate already?
We can eliminate D and B.
All right, so D and B, awesome choices for elimination. All right, let's go now with, it has to go through 0, 0. Let's examine A. Does A go through 0, 0 through that origin?
No.
Nope. So that one's going to be gone. All right. Let's look at F. Does that go through 0, 0?
E.
So you're looking at F. The origin is right here, and that's what I'm looking for. It has to pass through the origin for it to be proportional. So the only two left, they meet our criteria, right?
Yes.
Exactly. So now you've seen it where it's first it seems kind of daunting. It seems like, whoa, what are they asking me to do here? But with a graph, I actually, Ms. Prado, I don't know if she shows you some of these tricks or not, but definitely looking for like a smarter way of working, right? Like a faster way that's efficient for you. So when we're looking for that 0, 0 and it has to be a straight line, I could very quickly did what we just did, and you did it perfectly. So thank you for calling in tonight and being one of our awesome on-air callers. All right, Ms. Prado, back to you.
Hi. Okay. All right. So I have a question. We're going to take that equation and we're going to put it into a table and a graph.
Whoa.
We're going to do it all here.
Multiple representations.
We're a little slanty here tonight. It's like the Haunted Mansion at Disney, right?
Getting closer to spooky time.
That's right. Okay. So a proportional relationship is y equals 3/2 x. So what that means is we're going to take this 3/2 and we're going to plug it in. We're going to plug in these numbers and we're going to see what happens. So if we take y, which we don't know, y equals 3/2 times 0. That's what it's saying to do. We're going to take this x value and we're going to plug it in there.
Substitution.
Substitution. That's right. So we're going to get 3/2 times 0 is y equals 0. So remember, one of our rules about proportions is what? Has to go through the origin, has to go through 0, 0. So the next one we're going to come down to is we're going to plug in 1. Y equals 3/2 times 1. And that would give us y equals 3/2. Okay, so 3/2 is an improper fraction. And that would turn into what? One and a half. Yes?
Yes.
All right, next. So we're going to plug in our 2 for the x this time. So y equals 3/2 times 2. Now, I like to do this. I like to put it over 1. You know why?
Why?
Because then I can cross simplify.
Oh.
Okay? So when I cross simplify here, and we got times 2 over 1, we're going to cross simplify, and we're going to make the 2, and the 2 becomes 1 because you can cross simplify them. And you're going to get 3. Y equals 3. Now, you could have done it the other way, too, and gotten 6 over 2. But 6 over 2 still equals 3. All right. Then the next one. Y equals 3/2 times 3. Okay? So that's going to be multiply across. 3 times 3 is 9. 9 over 1. Okay? I'm sorry. 9 over 2. 2 times 1 is 2. So 9 over 2. So our answer then, our y would equal 9 over 2. So each time we're just substituting in the x value into our equation and solving. And 9/2 also equals 4.5. And then last, we're going to plug in 4. So y equals 3/2 times 4. And I'm going to put that over 1 to cross simplify again. And we're going to get y equals 6. All right, now we're going to take our ordered pairs and we're going to plug them in. So we're going to start with the first one, 0, 0. That goes down here. The next one, where x equals 1, that means you go over to the 1 on the x-axis. Y equals 1.5, so it's going to be about there. And then the next one, when x equals 2, y equals 3, about there. And the next one, when x equals 4, y equals, did I skip one? No, 6. Oh, wait, I did. I skipped 3 is 4.5. Sorry. 3 is 4.5, and 4 is 6. And as you can see, if I were on a coordinate plane, it'd be totally straight, right?
Right, we're just getting an idea.
Yes, but we're getting an idea. But when you draw this, it's going to be, when you put each of the ordered pairs on here, it's going to be a straight line that goes through the origin. And that is literally the definition of a proportional relationship. So,
very nice.
Ta-da! I'm pretty okay with my drawing.
Yes, I love your drawing. And we have Leo on the line who also loves your drawing.
Hi.
Hey, Leo.
Hi.
We have been doing proportional relationships, and we enjoy proportional relationships. I'll be the first one to admit, I love setting up a proportion, setting it up correctly, because there's so many different ways of doing it. And then as we do the math, we see all different ways of using that proportional relationship. One of the ways I'm going to show you on our board right now is that we're going to be given some information, okay? So I'm going to give you a graph, and my question is going to be, what is the constant of proportionality? Okay, so I was looking at my paper for a second to make sure, what is the constant of proportionality? So look at my board for a second, and I want us to think about this word, constant of proportionality. Proportionality. See, it sounds like the word proportion, right?
Yeah.
So looking at the board, I would tell you, we know some things about proportional relationships. We know that it has to go through the origin, which this one does. They actually tell us this is a proportional relationship. This is one of the points, ordered pair, 2, 6. So remember, that's x, y. And they want to know, what is the constant of proportionality? Now, had this been in a table, we would have had the point 0, 0 for sure, and the point 2, 6 for sure. Okay? So,
okay.
With the constant of proportionality, really what it's asking, this is the way that I would explain it to my students, what do you multiply the x by to get the y? Literally, it's that simple. All right?
0.
What did you say?
0 and 0.
So 0 multiplied by 0 gives me 0. What do I multiply 2 by to get 6?
3.
Very nice. So let's see if that works out. So the y value has to equal 3 times the x value. Are you okay with that? The way that I just wrote that? Okay. So here, if I would have put in a 0 for my x, I would have definitely gotten a value of 0 for my y. So if I multiply 3 times 2, I know I would have gotten 6. So for sure, this works out. So this is the equation that goes with this particular graph. But they really want to ask us, what is the constant of proportionality? So really what they're asking, like I said to you before, what do you multiply by? And you really told me the answer already, which was what?
Three.
So the constant of proportionality, we say, is 3. You're going to learn as you go through math class that this is also going to be considered the slope.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it's the constant rate of change. But a simplified way of doing that, as again, we show the different representations, is that it's just what do we multiply the y or the x by to get the y? Sometimes when it's a little tricky because the numbers are not friendly, this is what I do. Say, what's y divided by x? Because you know multiplication and division are opposites of each other as inverse operations. So when it gets a little tricky, you just say, okay, what's y divided by x? And I got my answer right away. And that's your constant of proportionality, which you'll see it sometimes labeled as the letter P. All right? So congratulations, Leo.
We have some t-shirt winners.
T-shirt winners.
Yay!
Whoa. Lots of winners in our program tonight. So here we go. Sienna from Walker, congratulations on the golden shirt. From Rogers, we have Hannah. And then from Barrington, we have Alexander. So yay, t-shirts.
Yay.
And we are now ready also to show you our Mathnasium beautiful slide. Coming to you from Mathnasium, if you notice, our proud sponsor here of Math Homework Hotline and our challenge question. So do call them in for a scheduling a free assessment. Guys, remember to make math a priority this school year. Discover why over 1 million parents have trusted Mathnasium to transform their children's math skills, build their confidence. Definitely live face-to-face instruction that is offered both in the center and online. But as you call into one of the nearest locations to you, notice on your screen we have some in Brandon, Carrollwood, Lutz, New Tampa, Riverview, South Tampa, and West Chase. Shouting out to Mathnasium because they are every step of the way with us and have been with us all along as our sponsors of the challenge question.
Yeah.
So excited to have our Mathnasium sponsor being not only there for us, but also for you on a daily basis. All right, Canella, what are we doing next?
Okay, Mathnasium is everywhere.
Yes.
All right, so I have a question that we're gonna go to here in just a second, but after this, I wanna do some shout outs before we forget.
Yes.
Okay? All right, so let's go to the board. So this question just says, is the relationship proportional? Looking at yet another slanted but beautiful table. And it says, if so, what is the constant of proportionality? So let's go over that again. So remember, if it is a constant of proportionality, the y over x will be the same every single time. Last time the x and y were long, this time the x and y are left to right. So horizontal versus vertical. All right, so first of all, what's the number one thing we got to make sure of? Remember, the number one rule is, does it go through the origin? The origin is 0, 0. It does. So far, so good. We're looking like we could possibly be a proportion. So next, I'm going to go to the y over x for each of these. So our y is -8/1. And then here, our y is -16, and our x is 2. And here, the y is -24, and the x is 3. And lastly, the y is -32, and the x is 4. So they are all different. And they're negative. Sometimes the kids will, when they're first learning, they'll get tripped up. Can it be negative? Of course it can be negative. That just means that the arrow would be going down on the coordinate plane, okay, from the origin. So it would look something like this, okay? Something like that. All right, so let's check. So -8/1 is -8. -16/2 is -8. -24/3 is -8, and -32/4 is -8. So it is. So it is definitely, yes, 100% a proportional relationship, and the constant of proportionality is -8. I picked that question to have a little side conversation about negative.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, when the kids first start, they, for some reason, will occasionally think that it can't be negative. Yes, it can be negative. Negative just means it goes down. Makes sense, right? Positive goes up, negative goes down. Yes, exactly. So I would like to give some shout outs because I did not create this beautiful set that is, I had a prop crew. I'm going to be honest with you. Ina gave the beautiful Mirabelle bunny. My Encanto shirt was actually given by Giada. And Olivia gave all the Encanto big posters that we got down there.
Beautiful.
So that's my prop crew. Shout out to the prop crew.
Ooh.
And didn't you have a shout out this week as well?
We did, you guys. Being Hispanic Heritage Month, we celebrate from September the 15th to October the 15th. So we want to do a little Spanish twist tonight. But as we were going from school to school, we noticed that some of our schools were doing door decorating contests. Mm. And one of the schools you'll see in the screen had little math symbols on their door, giving it our Spanish twist. So we'll see that in just a second here on your screen. Let's roll that picture. It is in Ms. Greer's class that we spied at Liberty Middle School. The little math symbols with the little sombrero on them. And there are little maracas, which we have some maracas on the set tonight.
So what, there's a pie up there in the upper right-hand corner.
And then towards the middle of the to the left is a little plus sign. And then
I see an equal sign. I see that.
They're so
cute. Did she make those?
I have no idea, but we spied some Spanish, Hispanic heritage.
I am completely impressed either way.
So shout out to Miss Greer at Liberty. She had no idea that we took that picture off of her Facebook. So it is what it is.
Still, shout out.
We have one more question for you that you're going to get this. All right. This is kind of like our cool down, and it's a Mickey Mouse has made it to our board. He has.
Yay,
Mickey ran at a rate of 6 miles per hour. What do you think about that?
I think that's
pretty big,
pretty fast. I mean, mice are really small.
Okay, so Mickey was running, you know, in full costume at 6 miles per hour. We want to write an equation that shows the number of miles he ran y in x hours. Again, guys, don't make this harder than what it needs to be. We've shown you a number of different ways to do that. If you notice, it's always going to be of the form y equals some number and then the letter x. All right. I love doing these because literally it's input versus output. You learn these when you were in elementary school, in versus out. So if I have 1 hour goes by, because this is going to be the number of hours, how many miles is that going to go to? Well, he says he ran 6 miles in 1 hour, right? So one times what is going to give me six? Canella, what do you think our students are going to say?
I'm going to go with six.
Six, right? So one times six. And if we use that whole idea of y divided by x, which is our constant of proportionality, six divided by one is definitely six. So we checked it out a couple of different ways. Okay.
You know, I wanted to say this too. Sometimes kids will get a little confused if it's not whole hours.
Yes.
Like if it were, you know, 2.5 hours or whatever.
Like that.
And so I just wanted to point out again that you can definitely do problems in decimal form or fraction form. My table, the one table did, in fact, remember I said 9 halves or 4.5. So, and then sometimes on a coordinate plane, we have to estimate.
Exactly.
So that's kind of that. So.
So guys, this all goes together, basically, whether it's given to you in the form of a word problem, you saw that today, or a graph or an equation, a table, we're always looking for that proportionality, if you will, right? And remember that for every 1 hour, he's going to go 6 miles. So in 2 hours, what's it going to be? 2 times 6. Is 12. In 3 hours, how long is going to be? 3 times 6 is 18, and so forth. So you can say as many hours as you want. If Mickey were to be doing this for 10 whole hours, he's going to have run 60 miles. That's a lot, all right? That's a lot of distance covered. But basically, all you're trying to do is write an equation. This constant of proportionality, you see it called different things, rate of change, slope,
rise over run,
exactly. So we just want to simplify it for you, depending on how you see it easiest for you. I like to see it in the form of an input output table and really go back to what is the question asking. We know that this was the number of hours x from the problem, there it is, that he ran was y, and that was the number of miles, so we knew here. And then once you have that set up, you just go back to the problem. What did they give you? 6 miles. So put that with the 6, which is the output, per 1 hour. That was with the input. And then you just think about it. Why did we get from one number to the next? You always multiply to get from that x to the y. If it's numbers like Canella was describing, where they're fractional values, just go back to y divided by x. What's the output divided by the input that corresponds with that particular ordered pair, all right?
I was going to say, I hope that if Mickey goes 60 miles,
yes,
I really hope he gets a bike.
Yeah.
If not a car.
And sometimes we've seen scooters or electronic bicycles.
Yeah.
The electric bikes.
So I was going to say, I wanted to shout out again to Hispanic Heritage Month and doing a little SEL here. I personally am not Hispanic, but I believe we have a host who is.
Oh!
So I thought maybe you would like to share a little bit of your personal background, your personal story, since this is personal to you more than me. So although you're my person, so that counts, right?
Your person. So you guys, basically I came, Maggie Mixon here, I came from Cuba when I was 5 years old. And I actually came only knowing how to speak Spanish. So when I was able to come from Cuba and I was, we start school in Cuba a little earlier than here in the United States. I was already, you know, had a little bit of schooling all in Spanish. I started kindergarten not knowing a lick of English. And I learned very quickly because I was very passionate about that and making it, you know, my own and whatnot. But bottom line is, it's like, just think about having that dual language, being able to embrace, you know, the different languages that we have and the food and the traditions and just, you know, everything that comes with the culture, if you will. So we are celebrating Hispanic Heritage Month, but, you know, there's so many cultures in our schools and in your lives that everybody's just, you know, really respectful and really enriching, if you will, to kind of have a little taste, if nothing else, no pun intended, with the Spanish food or different foods out there. But thank you for honoring that and bringing that to light. Today our challenge question, with our, when I said, for instance, I'll leave you with a couple words in Spanish, for instance. We said the seven dwarfs. Seven in Spanish is the number siete.
Siete. I'm learning Spanish.
And Snow White is Blanca Nieves.
Blanca Nieves?
There you go.
I did okay.
You sure did.
I just thought it would be awesome for you to share your story with the kids, because there are kids out there right now that have entered our school district that maybe are still learning English. And I think it just goes to show you that nothing will ever get in your way. It only makes you better. I also have an immigrant mother. I shared that last week, that I'm German. In fact, I was the only child who was born here in this country.
Wow.
So yes, I was the only one born on American soil. So, and I speak German and you speak Spanish.
I sure do.
So it just makes you better.
It does.
The more languages, the better, is what I'm saying. So,
guys, all right. And making us better is next week when we come back next Thursday. It'll be October the 20th. Our show will be on ratios and rates, going right along with this whole personal relationship idea. And our fun theme will be
Rays.
The Tampa Bay Rays.
Yay.
Go Rays. We're going to knock it out of the park.
Yay, Rays.
Talk to you guys soon. Enjoy your weekend and go Bucks.
Woo!
FSU.